Come to order, please. Good morning. Welcome to the Commissioners' meeting this date, Tuesday, January 15th, 2019. I am Randy Guy, President of Commissioners of St. Mary's County. I'd like to introduce the other Commissioners at this time. Today, to my right, Representative First Commissioner District, which includes Piney Point, Ridge, St. George's Island, Mr. Eric Colvin.
Good morning.
Mike Hewitt, who represents Second Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown Hollywood, is not here today. Today, to my left, representing the Third Commissioner District, which includes Charlotte Hall, Seventh District, Golden Beach, and McCashville, Mr. John O'Connor.
Good morning.
Representing the Fourth Commissioner District, which includes Lexington Park, some of California, Great Mills, and some of Hollywood, Mr. Todd Morgan. Seated at the end is Dr. Rebecca Bridges, our County Administrator. On my immediate right is Sharon Ferris, our recorder for today. Amy Carter, our video media producer, is behind the glass. Please turn your cell phones off or on vibrate. When you come to the presenter's table, please approach by coming down the center aisle. And remember, this meeting is being televised, so you need to speak clearly and directly into the microphone for recording purposes. At this time, we have the invocation pledged by Commissioner Colvin. Please stand.
Please bow with me. Almighty Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the beauty that you gave us over the weekend and the snowstorm, Lord. We thank you for the safety of our county, Father, and for all that you've done for us. We are a richly blessed county. Our prayer this morning, Lord, is that you would guide us, that you would give us wisdom as we manage the resources that you've entrusted to us. In your Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Carlton.
Thank you.
And next, I need the approval of the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So moved. We go right to the County Administrator.
Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. Commissioners, I bring to your attention your draft meeting agendas. Just a note that there is no meeting of the County Commissioners next week for January 22nd. So your first draft agenda is January 29th. You begin at 8:30 a.m. with receptions for boards, committees, and commissions. Then you recognize your annual recognition ceremony for all your volunteer boards, commissions, and committee members. Then you have the decision for the proposed revisions to the St. Mary's County Ethics Ordinance from the County Attorney's Office. You have a request for public hearing for the Sheriff's Office Retirement Plan Board document, Amendments 1 through 15, from the Department of Human Resources. And then you have your legislative updates. The next week on February 5th, you begin your business meeting here at 9 a.m., a proclamation for African American History Month. The College of Southern Maryland State of the College is scheduled that morning, and then legislative updates as well for your business meeting. For this morning, you have item B from Circuit Court for Juvenile Drug Court Program Transfer of Funds. The Honorable Judge Michael Stamm, Administrative Judge. Arthur Shepherd, Director, Recreation and Parks. Looks like Pete Cucinata, the Coordinator. And Johnny Woods. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
Good morning, board guys.
I don't think it's a secret that the Juvenile Drug Court program has been around 14 years, and I've been its presiding judge for the last 13. But as time goes on, things change in the community, and our program has, since last February, slowly been closing down. We have what we called the Drug Court Advisory Committee, which was a group that oversaw what we were doing and also did fundraising. And we had a young man who passed away, whose family donated money from his inheritance, well, not his inheritance, but his insurance. And no, he didn't die from an overdose. But this young man's money was put in this pool. And we've used this money for extras that we didn't have to come back and ask for with the county. Things such as scholarship, occupational training, and we've had quite a few of our graduates come back and do those programs. Because the program is closing down, the advisory committee wanted to find a worthy source for that income. And as I was telling one of the commissioners earlier, this will be a few times you're going to see a government or state official giving money back to the county versus asking for it.
Hopefully, and it's a trend that we'll see more.
Well, don't get used to it. But anyway, the fact is that we got together to try to figure out a worthy group, and we wanted it to still help the children of our community. So Parks and Rec with Art, we spoke with him, and we have here a fairly sizable check, which makes up the funds that are not been escrowed for the students and the training programs the children are already in. And I keep calling them children. These are over 18 now as they do these programs. The condition that we asked for, and which Parks and Rec agreed to, was it could only be for children from St. Mary's. It had to be children. And to try to reach as many of the young people in our community and not be scholarship for the summer programs, both sports, art, culture, and whatever Art and his crew felt were appropriate. So frankly, the committee was unanimous to give back the money. Well, it's not really giving back because it was, they are the ones that raised it. But we have a size of $44,000 that we would like to give the county. I don't know how you endorse a check this big, but at any rate.
So it's large, it's literally and metaphorically.
It's not with pleasure that we're shutting the program down, but society has changed by decriminalizing certain amounts of marijuana, which is where our kids mostly came from. So we are have one or two students left.
We have two officially.
Two. And the program will not stop until they're either successful or they're terminated from the program. I'm just continue to do that even though the program itself is over with.
Well, I move to accept the transfer of donated funds from the Juvenile Drug Court Program to Recreation and Parks in the amount of $44,000 and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
So moved.
I'd like to say, Judge, it was an honor serving on your board before I became commissioner. I know you did a lot of good work with you and Pete and Johnny and others for the youth of the community. I know your recidivism rate was astounding compared to the northern counties, except there was a different way we did math up north versus the way we did math down here, and it sometimes caught us. But I think that you're under your leadership, and we're Pete and Johnny, it was a great program, and thank you for all your time that you volunteered to do in helping those kids out.
I'm pretty proud of the program, Todd. We received national recognition. We've had recognition from the state, from the county. We've had wonderful people like yourself, Johnny, Glenn Ives, Carl Franz, and Simon Armitage, T-Bone, Terry, all been on the committee and continue to serve with it. And frankly, it's bittersweet, but I believe this from the committee will help more kids in our community and continue helping for a few years.
Great. Thank you very much. You.
And before we do it, I'd also like to say thank you for, you know, trusting the county to continue this mission. Thank you for trusting Art Shepherd to keep this shepherded along as we go. But it is really an honor to receive this. I know there's plenty of other choices that could have been had, and thank you for the trust.
You know, thank you, Commissioner O'Connor. The thing is, people forget is I may be a Seventh Circuit judge, but I still have St. Mary's.
That's right.
You know, all the way. All right, thank you.
Can we get a picture?
Commissioner's up front.
Yes. We're gonna, yes.
And Commissioners, item C is from the Circuit Court also for the MDH, BHA, Adult and Juvenile Drug Court. It looks like Pete Cucinato from our Drug Court Programs is presenting, and would you please introduce your guests?
Delsenia Dames Tucker, I'm the Fiscal Specialist.
Thank you. Nice to meet you. Thanks for joining us this morning.
Well, we've been working with the Maryland Health Department, along with DHA, to help further our recovery programs along for both the juvenile and the adult. And we've recently taken over administration, and originally the budget for this account was $69,000, but the state had found there was extra money to move the program further. So we got an additional $15,530 to work the program. And what we request for you today is to accept this additional award so that we can amend our budget and use the funds to further along this program.
This is supplemental to what we already received, and it will go to our treatment provider, who's already expanding services for drug testing with the additional funds for the rest of this fiscal year.
I move to accept the additional award for the St. Mary's County Health Department Project MD-1994 in the amount of $84,607 and approve the related budget amendment to increase the project funding by $15,530 and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item D is from MedCom to introduce the Maryland Water Quality Financing Administration loan application. George Erickson, Executive Director, and Patty Stigman, Chief Financial Officer, presenting this morning, and Christy Hollander, Chief Engineer. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome all.
Thank you for those introductions. Congratulations, Commissioners, Mr. Colvin, on the election. And good job on the snow removal. And we appreciate it this year. We talked with Tony Jones on our conference calls that Dr. Bridget arranges, and you included MetCom on your media releases, our status. So we really appreciate that. That's the first time that's happened in, I think, the history. So we're working well together. What we have today is a application in accordance with Chapter 113-2C. It's a new process. You didn't want us to wait until we got to the actual borrowing stage. This is an MDE loan. The way MDE loans work, they don't authorize the loan until you bid the project. So it's a heck of a time to come back to the county commissioners, talk about debt, talk about project status when the bid's already in place. So Chapter 113 was changed to require us to come before you just for the application process. So between the application process and the actual award, you're looking at a period of about 18 months. This is phase two of St. Clement Shores. Phase one is almost completed. It's waterline replacement. No new customers. It's just a replacement of aging infrastructure that's over 60 years old. This is old galvanized pipe with poor service connections, poor fire hydrant pressure, et cetera, and we're just upgrading that. The interesting thing about the MDE loans is that their interest rate is really low. It's only about 1.7%, which is really good. And the loan application is for $3.687 million, which is consistent with the approved capital budget, which is also in your packages. The good news about this project is this has been already included in the debt capacity calculations that your CFO actually provides. There was an update provided to you in December prior to your 2020 budget work sessions, so this debt is already actually calculated. We'll be back before you, depending on the motion that you approve today, to actually do what we normally would do and get your authorization to borrow and get your backing in full faith and credit. But we're not at a point yet where we're ready to bid. We're only at the design stage now, and we'll be bidding it next spring. So we're looking at maybe summer 2020 before this project actually gets started.
And how long will it take to complete once the process, or once the contract is awarded?
It should be about eight to nine months.
So it'll take longer to get from here to the contract award than it will to finish the project.
Absolutely, and here's the irony. When we come back and award it, MDE will not give MetCom the money until they know the number. So we give them the number at the time of bid. It takes them 6 to 7 months to actually provide the money to us. So in our solicitations, we have to ask the contractor to hold his prices for 6 to 7 months. Mm. Yeah. So it's even longer than you point out, Commissioner Morgan. But yes, the project will take less than the application and the loan approval.
Government at its best.
I think you guys are doing a great job over there, everybody.
We appreciate it. And also in your packages is a status of outstanding loans. That's always been an issue. And back in our fall 2017 meeting, we had about $32 million in outstanding loans. That would be loans that we borrowed and hadn't drawn down. As of our fall meeting this past year, it was below $23 million, so we knocked $10 million off of that. In our immediate queue, which is either in the bid or award process, we have another $13 million. And in the fall and the spring of this year, the last $10 million should be drawn down or at least awarded. I say drawn down, but awarded.
Good.
So that old chunk of money that's been a concern mm-hmm. for the past 2 years, mm-hmm. we will have, I won't say eradicated, but we will have awarded against all of that. So we'll be in good shape.
And yes, you're making progress.
Yes,
and
sir.
You're moving in the best direction under with the team that you have. So everything is positive.
Well, Mr. President, I move to approve the St. Clements Shores Water System Phase 2 Maryland Water Quality Financing Application in the amount of $3,687,434 to the Maryland Department of the Environment per Chapter 113-2C of the Code of St. Mary's County and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
First and second, is there any discussion? Is this to redo the sediment ponds at
No, sir. This is all water line replacement.
This fund is all for the water line replacement?
All water line replacement.
Okay. I have a first, second, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item E is from the Sheriff's Office, the GOCAP Award for the J. Edward Byrne Memorial Justice Assistance Grant Opioid Coordinator. Captain Sweeney presenting this morning. Good morning.
Good morning,
Captain.
Well, we had applied for the grant hoping to create a new position of opioid coordinator. Of course, a lot of people with similar problems that are applying for grants as well. We didn't get what we'd hoped. So what we plan to do is use the funding we did receive to support our opioid operations with overtime.
And for the public's benefit, would you please explain how and what you're going to do with the monies, please?
Well, we're going to use that to support any our opioid investigations, which include, the entire operations include mapping, includes meeting with community partners, with the community in different at different times, educational purposes, as well as investigations. We had approximately 30 fatalities just this past year and more than that the year before. And that's just the fatalities we've had, which require significant manpower. So we're hoping what we did receive we could use to help offset the overtime for that.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Move to approve the FY 2018 Edward J. Byrne Memorial Justice Assistance BJAG Opioid Coordinator Grant Award Project US 1922 from the Governor's Office of Crime Control and Prevention on behalf of the St. Mary's County Sheriff's Office for overtime costs associated with opioid relief operations, investigation, overdose mapping, and other related tasks in the amount of $41,451 and the related budget amendment to establish budget authority and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
I have a first and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item F is from the Office of the County Attorney to introduce revisions to Airport Advisory Committee bylaws and to repeal and reenact resolution establishing governing advisory boards, committees, councils, and commissions. Mr. Weisskopf, County Attorney, presenting this morning. Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
You're bringing before you two items, a resolution and also bylaws. The resolution would be to change the name from the Airport Advisory Committee to Airport Advisory Board is all that the resolution would do. And the bylaws really came about because the county finally has an airport manager. So we wanted to put the airport manager into the bylaws. One, it makes the airport manager an ex officio member of the board with non-voting privileges. It also states that she will be the airport manager will be the one to provide technical support, advisory support to the board, and also that the airport manager would be the one to ensure that the agenda is set. And the other changes were just simply going from, you know, Board of County Commissioners to, or, you know, the proper name and such. And that's really all the changes. I don't know if anybody has any questions about any of them or.
So this is a good thing. This is a necessary step for a growing airport in my mind.
Yes, yeah. I believe so.
I would agree with you. It's, you know, we've gone from a sleepy airport to a busy airport
yes.
that is rapidly growing. We have companies from around the world looking to establish their businesses there. Some have. We never had a full-time dedicated airport manager. It's always a split duty. So I think this is an important step in economic development in how we run the airport and setting clear lines so we can continue the positive initiatives that we've had there. So, it's just one of those things that we have to do.
Plus, actually, why are we changing it from a commission to a board?
That was, I think, just the one of Commissioner's suggestions. We certainly don't have to. I think it's in keeping with what we've been doing with most of the other 32 or so boards that we have. We've been kind of slowly changing the name, making them all boards instead of some are boards, some are committees, some are, just for ease of.
I'm going to assume that as we move forward with this, that as we look more closely at the airport regulations and master plans and things like that, we'll be incorporating these changes into that document.
And so I don't believe we'd have to incorporate those changes into the bylaws, no.
How about the operating procedures?
Those, my understanding is DPW&T is presenting a briefing to the commissioners on the 29th to go over the new rules that they're proposing in addition to the standard operating procedures and minimum standards.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
That's a separate thing.
Yes.
Yeah, I'll
but we'll bring everything on as far as these boards to standardize everything mm-hmm. with all the boards we have. Bring a standard so everybody follows a similar same bylaws, same type of meeting laws, all into one.
We're trying to, yes.
Yeah. All right. Well, I move to approve and authorize the Commission President to sign the revised bylaws of St. Mary's County Airport Advisory Board.
Second.
First and second, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
I move to approve the resolution to appeal and reenact provisions establishing and governing advisory boards, councils, committees, and commissions.
Second.
Our first, second, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
While we're on the topic of the airport real quick, because I know we're going to have a presentation on the 29th, there's been a lot of contention about the draft ordinance and the supporting documents. This is something that, and the reason I'm doing this now is this way hopefully staff can get some guidance to prepare some stuff to present to us as well. For 6 years, this has gone back and forth, and we got presented with something that's still a very contentious document with stakeholders on both sides that don't feel happy with it. And quite frankly, you read through it, and you can only put so much lipstick on a pig is the nicest way I can say it. I've used other terms. What I'm hoping for is that since this is just a whole bunch of problems that we have in here one way or another, is that we do the same thing that we did with the Department of Emergency Services, which is we have somebody from the outside come in, whether it's a true consulting firm that's familiar in the airport industry that can go ahead and start from scratch or take this and recraft it one way or another, and get something that they can meet with all stakeholders, do a SWOT analysis, get everybody's input from an unbiased point of view. So there's no emotion involved in crafting this document. Obviously, I'm not asking for a decision today on this. What I'm doing is hopefully, publicly asking staff, give them some guidance to prepare something to present to us in their next presentation. On the 29th, right? Yeah. That shows, hey, these are consulting firms within the state, the nation. This is what the average cost may be if we want to bring one in to go ahead and redo this document. I mean, if we can do it the same way we did with Department of Emergency Services, I mean, there's an 800% improvement in how we're doing operations over there. So I just like to give them the guidance. And if the rest of the commissioners concur, they can go get those prices and bring that plan back to us. So like I said, I'm not asking for a decision on using a consulting firm.
So I definitely concur. I think Commissioner O'Connor's correct. The airport is growing. There's so much great stuff being done there, and whatever steps we take now, I think we want to do what's right, and we want to manage it correctly and not create any more controversy with this. So I think taking another look at these rules and standard operating procedures would be a smart decision.
That's fine. Will staff have enough time to get this stuff done in 2 weeks?
We'll do the best we can, and yeah.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
Cool.
As long as we got somewhere to start, that's the thing.
Even if it's in draft, we'll have something.
That's fine. Perfect. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the guidance.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And last on your agenda of county administrator time is to review the St. Mary's County Government Facility Space Needs. And we'd like to postpone that for today, if that's okay, Commissioner.
Yeah, that's fine.
So postpone this till next week?
2 weeks.
It's 2 weeks. You don't have a meeting next week, so it'd come back to you on the 29th.
29th, okay.
That sounds
good. And in addition to that, the same thing with the executive session. I'd like to go ahead and postpone that.
Right.
You'd like to postpone the executive session to the 29th as
yes.
well?
Yes, please. Do you need a motion for that, or since it's on the agenda, or are you good to go?
As long as I have consensus.
Okay.
Agreed.
Commissioners agreed with that?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's good.
Okay. Okay. And so next on your agenda, Commissioners, is the presentation from the St. Mary's College for their annual State of the College. They're scheduled for 10, so you're running a little bit early. So would you like to take a recess and come back at 10 or 9:45 if you hope that they're here
so,
early?
Dr. Bridget, what you're saying is when Commissioner Hewitt is not here, we run ahead of schedule? That's not what I'm saying. That's what you're saying? Just kidding.
No, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. We
run
ahead of schedule.
Commissioner Hewitt, we miss you.
And I might mention item 4 is also commissioner time if you'd like to do that now. You know, or you want to do it later.
Get it out of the way.
Yeah, we can do it.
We'll do commissioner's time now, and we'll start with Commissioner Morgan.
Thank you, Commissioner.
President. A few things. Last Friday, many of us had the opportunity to attend, I guess we'll call him now, Judge Stanilonis' investiture. It was a really, really nice event. It was well crowded, nice reception down at Bay District Firehouse, and thanks to 7th District Optimist for coming all the way down to Lexington Park to help out down there. So that was really good. On Saturday, I had the opportunity to address the UCAC at their annual meeting. Nice attending meeting. I want to thank Mike Brown for inviting us over, talk about what's going on in the county, and hear some of those folks' concerns along the way. Lastly, a couple funerals this past week. One was for former Councilman Tommy Coombs up here in Leonardtown, more or less an institution inside the town of Leonardtown, and very sorry, our condolences go to his family. The second one I read about in the paper last night. I'm not real good at keeping up on the news. It was for Norris Shepherd. Norris Shepherd, he and his wife Betty have been married for 64 years. And most of you don't know Norris and Betty. If anybody goes to county fair and goes into the ag booth and looks how big the pumpkins are and the squashes are and all the tobacco that's hanging on the wall, for as long as I can remember, Norris and Betty have sat in those little chairs on the left-hand side as you walk in and watched over that booth, and it was their booth. And their kids and their grandchildren have for years canned, pickled, done everything. So if you go down the left wall where all the awards are for, you know, the various sundry products, you can see their names and their kids' names and the family names all over them. So I just want to say today to the Shepherd family and to Betty, you know, Norris will be deeply missed. And on behalf of all of us, our condolences to your family. Thank you.
Okay, it was a privilege to attend the investiture.
You're
Judge.
From New York. I know you can't talk.
Yeah, that's it. It's a New York thing. He got sworn in. That's it. Forget about it.
Yeah, he got sworn in. Yeah. How's that?
But for Judge Stanilonis, very good friend, and you know, I consider his family, and to see that next step in the legal career happen is not something you get to see every day. I sat there and I told him, remember when the lawyers and the cops, mainly the cops, are sitting there, you look 20 feet tall, and I do not envy his position, because he is tasked with dealing out perfect justice in an imperfect system, in an imperfect world. And that is probably one of the hardest things to ever do. And you have to have very, very broad shoulders to do that. So it's something that I know he doesn't take lightly, and it was just an honor to see. So it's nothing I've ever attended before either. So that was definitely a first for me. Saturday was a definitely a busy day. There's 4 different events going on, and I tried to make as many as I could. Unfortunately, the way it works is these events either are going at the same time, overlapping, some end earlier than the others. But I started out with Southern Maryland BMX at Parks and Recs, through help of this board, was able to go ahead and get lights put in out there. And now for the first time ever, they're gonna have a night series race under the lights They're looking at national races coming. They're looking at a lot of positive things. On top of that, there looks like they're going to get a start gate, compressor, and some fencing up there. So it's really bringing them to the next level of where they need to be. And, you know, they were already on the map for St. Mary's County, but now it's right there. And I'm looking forward to seeing a national race there that actually it's one of the televised races that happens. And I know Chris Castellamus is watching it. And many thanks to Art Shepard and his entire crew over there that made this happen. It's a big deal. And to see get there and see all these people and how it touches the community, and you talk about tons of kids, family-friendly event. I mean, it was amazing. It really was. And I do have a plaque for the commissioners from them. I did not bring it today, but I will. If it said John O'Connor, I'd keep it myself, but it says Commissioners of St. Mary's County. So I'm going to bring that in. Hang it in the central hallway. Yeah. Congratulations to the 7th District Volunteer Rescue Squad. Unfortunately, that was the one event I was not able to make. At the same time, I left Southern Maryland BMX. I had another business meeting with a group that's looking at the airport for hopefully some flights back and forth throughout the region. We don't know if that's going to happen, but it was a very preliminary meeting, and it takes years to establish these things. And then because Hollywood was one that ran late, I was able to make it to Hollywood Volunteer Fire Department's installation, and thanks to them for having me there. I think the airport is the hot button. That's what we're all talking about now, transportation. It's important to realize that as we're growing, there's always growing pains that happen with things, but the team, this board, and Commissioner Jarbo, when he was sitting in Commissioner Colvin's seat, worked diligently to get this airport moving in the direction that it is now. So nothing that we're doing is to slight any one individual. It's about the fact that we're growing, and we have an airport manager, and the airport manager needs to manage the airport. And you know, when we're looking at these things and we need opinions and we need expert advice for particular subjects, we're able to go to the airport advisory board now and say, what do you think? But when it comes down to what is the price of fuel, we have an airport manager that can figure that out and let the commissioners know. So it to me, this is a step in the right direction, and I hope this change is embraced. And I hope that moving forward, we can build these relationships further to help St. Mary's County establish jobs. And I used the term earlier, we want to have this nice and calm, because when there's turbulent skies, the pilot finds smooth air. So we want to make sure everything is nice and smooth running down at that airport. And other than that, you know, the snow removal was great. And I definitely hope everybody's staying warm and be careful out there.
Good. So first off, I want to wish everybody a happy National Strawberry Ice Cream Day. That's what today is. It's a cold day to wish that, but that's what today is. I was not able to attend Judge Stanilonis's investiture, but I send him my best wishes. But I was able to attend the Farm Bureau's legislative dinner on Friday night, so I want to thank the Farm Bureau for having me there. It was the entire state delegation was there, Senator Jack Bailey, Delegate Brian Crosby, Matt Morgan, Jerry Clark, and we had a great time answering some questions. It was a wonderful dinner. It was very good. I also attended Hollywood Volunteer Fire Department's installation dinner with Commissioner O'Connor. That was just a wonderful time, a great group of volunteers. I'm just blown away and impressed by all that they do. And the auxiliary presented a check for, I believe, $75,000.
Yeah, $75,000.
Yeah. Incredible. And two new apparatus. They're doing great. So thank you to all the volunteers over there. That's wonderful. And finally, thank you to our road crews. They did a great job removing the snow. It was just beautiful weekend seeing all the snow, but there were people out there working hard. And I know that there was concerns from some citizens who might have had their driveways blocked by the snow removal off the road. And we understand that. And I just I encourage everyone to have a little bit of patience. The snow will melt. And it looks like we might be on tap for some additional weather this coming week and weekend. But just be prepared, stay patient, check on your neighbors, especially the elderly, and help each other out. And finally, it's Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday. We'll celebrate it on Monday for Martin Luther King Jr. Day, but today is his actual birthday, so I just want to acknowledge that. So, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole. Very good. Very good. Thank you, Commissioners. I did go to the 7th District rescue squad's dinner and presentation. Unfortunately, I was under the weather last week, terrible cold. I'm feeling a lot better now, so I only stayed for a short time there. Didn't stay through the entire operation. But once again, I do thank all those volunteers we had. Even though it was snowing, we got there. They packed the auditorium, and everybody seemed to be having a good time and a good turnout for the presentations and everything. And I want to reemphasize, too, that I know you hear a lot of things about the airport, and we at this board is really trying to diversify our economy outside of the naval base. Even though we appreciate the government being here, they're a big part of our community here, and we support it 100%. But we also need to look at other avenues outside of the government and try to diversify a little bit. And the airport seems to be a key thing. We're looking forward to hopefully this year getting approval for our we already got the major university present here, but get this third building, as everybody calls it, in place. Will be a big research center, further educational resource for us, and that would be a big turnout for us, a big venue to continue. So with all that said, we're going to have a minor recess. What do you think, about 10 minutes, 15 minutes?
Probably 20, till they get here.
Yeah, till they get here, so.
Make it 10.
Do you want to do 10 minutes?
How about 10-minute recess? So we're not going to recess. We're waiting for the St. Mary's College to come forward.
Oh,
thank
look,
you.
Here they come.
Wait.
Oh.
Here Walking they come. In. Come on in,
Ship.
If we give us a recess, get them set
Let's
up.
Go ahead and recess. Okay. We'll recess for 10 minutes.
Thank you.
suppose. Can I get him checked out again here?
They're tapped. It's the government's.
We're back from our recess. We now have Dr. Bridget here.
Yes, this is St. Mary's College with their annual State of the College presentation. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Dr. Jordan.
Good morning.
Morning, Ms. Jackson.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Same to you. Thank you very much.
We really appreciate the opportunity to give you an update as to what is going on in that little gym you have down at the southern end of the county this morning. I will make this presentation primarily with my colleague, Chip Jackson, who's in a new position at the college now. He was our vice president for business and finance, and now he's in a different role because he lived long enough to retire, and now he is our government relations person.
So retired and brought him back, huh?
Brought me back. Sometimes you just can't let them go, right? So this morning I will very quickly give you a snapshot of the college, discuss our local impact and engagement with the community. Chip and I will talk about, very briefly, some capital projects that are coming online within the next couple of years, and then discuss our state and national prominence, in addition to answer any questions you may have. St. Mary's College is the public honors college. I will go into more detail about that towards the end of my presentation, but it is the only four-year institution of higher education in Southern Maryland. We have about 1,600 students. The vast majority of them are undergraduates, and that's why most of our programming is directed that way. We have 25 majors that we offer and 28 minors. We also have an MAT program in education that's one of the finest in the state, and the majority of those MAT recipients stay in Southern Maryland, or at least in the state somewhere. Importantly, as we think about the future of the county, about all the economic development that's going on here, it's important to note that 31% of our graduates have degrees in the STEM fields. St. Mary's County is a significant supplier of students in the college. Over years, it's been a steady supplier of students, and in the last couple of years, the number of students we get from the county has increased. So much so that St. Mary's County is now the fourth largest feeder of students to St. Mary's College. And interestingly, if you look at what's going on with the community college, now 40% of our transfer students come from the College of Southern Maryland. And that is major for us, and it tells you about the pipeline of students coming through and how important it is to try to keep our students here in the county. Looking at how we're able to keep our students in the county, on this next slide, we show the impact on the local workforce that 5% of our new students come from the county, but looking at who's living in the county, 12% of the years, last couple of years, stay in the county, and that could be more. But again, we have to think about economic diversification and how to find a way to keep that brain trust here in St. Mary's County. The economic impact of what we do in St. Mary's County, I believe, is significant. We're the 12th largest employer in the county, and between our faculty, staff, and alumni, we contribute about $210 million annually to the economy of Southern Maryland. When we think about the role of the college, we believe we are an excellent community resource. When you think about entertainment, the cultural and intellectual resources we supply to St. Mary's County, we all know about the The River Concert Series that is a major draw in the summertime. We appreciate your support in the past. We understand that times are hard and economically the support decreased, but we hope that you will continue to support that because it is major entertainment for the residents of the Southern Maryland and St. Mary's County in particular. And when you think about what happens on the 4th of July, we pay for those fireworks, and lots of people in the county come, so we appreciate your support in that respect as much as possible.
It was very well done this year. Great fireworks this year. That was a good concert and good fireworks.
Well, thank you. We're also working You know, oftentimes there are town-gown relationships that are strained or not strained. At St. Mary's College, we continue to try to enhance our relationship with the community. And in so doing, when we think about the River Concert Series, how important that is, how can we draw more people to the college to listen to different kinds of music? So, you know, throughout the academic year, we have a variety of different kinds of concerts. We're also beginning a new music festival starting this summer before the River Concert Series to connect us better with the community and have broader participation. Right now we're calling it Mulberry Music Festival Act One, and we hope we'll be able to see some of you in the community there. We provide lectures, symposia, and speakers, bringing nationally renowned and international speakers to this campus. And of course, athletics are incredibly important, and our pool, you know, is probably one of the fastest. That's the reputation in the Mid-Atlantic region, and it is utilized by a lot of individuals and organizations in Southern Maryland. Our students, faculty, and staff are engaged in the community as volunteers. We usually volunteer between 12,000 and 20,000 hours per year to Southern Maryland, majority of that being in St. Mary's County. We spend a lot of time at Habitat for the Humanities, for Humanity. We spend a whole bunch of hours in the schools helping to tutor students both in school and after school. And of course, our students are contributing to the intellectual well-being and lifestyle of the county with their research experiences, many of them with Pax River, others with other private organizations and on campus. When we think about the things that we provide, you know we have a new stadium coming online. It is the Jamie L. Roberts Stadium. Jamie was a student at the college. She was a three-sport athlete who was tragically killed in an accident. But this stadium came about because we have a new academic building coming online, and we had to put it on our athletic fields, so we had to build a new athletic stadium complex. This complex will have state-of-the-art fields that will be available for the community to use as well. We have a new turf field, we have a grass field, and we have this building in the middle of it that it's a good place to entertain for people in the community as well. When we were constructing the stadium and doing the preliminary work, you know the St. Mary's County is incredibly historic, and you have to do archaeological work when you start any kind of construction project. When we were doing our archaeology work, we discovered that there were two slave quarters from different centuries in the county there, and that those are really significant with respect to the amount of information and artifacts we were able to get about the people who lived there. And it really is a story of resilience. When we're talking about what should be done at this site, because we didn't own the land when the slaves were there, but it's ours now, and it's our responsibility to do the right thing here. We have engaged people in the community to imagine what should happen there. How do you commemorate it properly? How do you use it for the county and the region, not just for the college? In so doing, we have a commemoration site that's going to be constructed right as you go towards the athletic fields to give people pause and help them understand what it means. We've engaged the community. We're also bringing in, we've gotten it down, we had 58 international and national artists compete for this project. We interviewed 28 of them. We have 8 coming to the campus at the end of February to pitch their stories, so to speak. We invite you all to come and listen to help us decide which one is worthy of this type of project that is for educational purposes, it is for community purposes, it is also can be for tourism down in the southern part of St. Mary's County. We have, I mentioned briefly, a new academic building coming on, which is the reason we had to displace our athletic fields. What's important here is that we know how much everyone appreciates our music department because of all of the concerts and things. Music department will get new facilities. Our educational studies supplies, our MAT students will get a new space. We will have a cafe because, you know, trying to eat down there at the southern part of the county is a little bit more challenging, and so this will be open to the community members. And also important is that we will have a 700-seat auditorium that's not like anything that is in the county or in Southern Maryland, actually, that will be open for people in the community to use that facility as well. Another sign of how we're trying to, as we advance the college, to also make sure that the region is advanced in St. Mary's County.
Wow.
Check.
So thank you. We know in your capital budget this year you put money aside to do the preliminary planning for improvements to Mattapani Road. As you know, Mattapani Road is a historic road. As you come down from the northeast towards Route 5, it was improved 30-some years ago, but stopped as it got to the college for because of concerns about archaeological resources. It's time now to improve that road. There's been many accidents on that road. Our students run and bicycle along the road. We're very grateful that the county has now started to fund the planning and the archaeological research that needs to happen. Just talked to John a few minutes ago before the meeting about how we're going to now work with Historic St. Mary's City, the college, and the Public Works Department to start beginning the planning for that project. It's been a long time. We're very, very grateful that the county is supporting that project.
Thank you, Chair.
Could you go back 1 second, please? Could you tell me the pedestrian walkways? It seems like it goes from the campus up 5 to Northfield. Is that right?
Yes, there's a new walkway, if that's your question, Commissioner Morgan.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out where and why. I mean, I see where.
Yes.
My more question is why.
The main issue is that the traffic of students, whether they're going to what we call Northfields, where there used to be the barn, where it's teams practice, mostly club sport teams, crossing the bridge at that creek, where it's pond, we call it, is very dangerous. The road is so narrow, there's no shoulder. And whether it's students going to athletic practices or people who are just riding their bikes, it's a very, very dangerous section at that culvert. This project extends the sidewalks that are already through the campus across St. John's Pond and head towards admissions, picks it up there, and then builds a boardwalk parallel and on the side of the road across that pond so you don't have that interference between pedestrians, bicyclists, and motorists. It's funded by the federal government, the state. We've been in planning and design, and construction should start hopefully this summer on that project.
Okay, thank you.
It's also important for the participants who come to the River Concert
yes.
Series, because there's a huge crowd and they park near the North Fields and they're trying to get to campus to go to the River Concert. It's very dangerous for them. So thank you, Chip. So I've spent a few minutes talking about St. Mary's College, its impact locally. But when you think about St. Mary's College, one thing that I've noticed since I've been here, many people in the county don't know the college. They get us confused with other institutions. They don't know where we're located, which seems a little bit of a disconnect because the college is actually a national player. And so I want to talk about, really, the significance of St. Mary's College on a national level. In 1992, the state legislators designated St. Mary's College as a public honors college. This is significant. And it's significant because they recognize the value of the educational experience you got there, but also that something special was going on down there, and that they were calling us a hidden gem. But when they made us the national, they made us the public honors college, that is the first public institution in the nation to get that designation, and right now there's only one other because it is incredibly hard feat to pull off. So when you think about the mission of being a public honors college, that means you have to be liberal arts college, but you have to provide the academic excellence that's akin to what you get in those elite private institutions. Because you're public, you have to think about access and affordability, but we're an honors college, which means there has to be rigor in everything that we offer. How do you do that and balance it? And that requires you to think about curricular innovation and also how to plan appropriately and not come up with crazy budgets, because that will really raise tuition out of the water, and that's not what we're about. Being a public institution, thinking about access, affordability, and diversity means that we're not just going after the students that have the highest test scores and the highest GPAs. We're going after those students that have the potential and the motivation to succeed in a rigorous academic environment. And that is really important for us there. Given these high standards that we have, one would think that kids would graduate with lots of debt. They wouldn't graduate on time, but the data indicate that nationally we are doing some of the best jobs with respect to graduating our students, having them prepared for lifelong success with low debt. We're the eighth highest four-year graduation rate in the country in the public sector. You might say, well, eighth out of how many? There are 2,000 public four-year institutions in the country. To be ranked eighth is a tremendous feather in our cap. Our students graduate extremely low student loan default rate. Is that significant? Yes, because liberal arts colleges are expensive. It's an expensive endeavor, and to have students low default rates and our students have the lowest debt load of all public institutions in the state says a lot about what we do to provide them with financial aid and scholarships. It also suggests that they're graduating with the ability to get a job. If you look at loan default rates, we're at 2.3%. The national average is 10.8%. That's a significant difference. A high percentage of our graduates are employed, continuing their education, or engaged in volunteer service like the Peace Corps within 6 months of graduation. For the class of 2017, that was almost 92% of our students were engaged at that level. The national average is 84%. And importantly, 64% of our graduates are accepted in a graduate or professional school like medical and dental school within 5 years of graduation. That tells you that academically they are prepared to be successful at the next level. So all of these things that we do, when we're talking about our return of investment, has given us huge accolades nationally. We're the 95th best liberal arts college, public and private, in the nation. You said 95 out of how many? Because if it's only 96, then it doesn't matter. But there are over 300 public and private liberal arts colleges in the nation. The fact that we're in the top 100, that says a lot. If you look at public liberal arts colleges, there are about 50 of them. We're ranked fifth or sixth, it depends on the year. If you then take away the military academies, we're ranked first or second every year for the public liberal arts colleges. We're 28th best national liberal arts colleges, according to Washington Monthly. This is important because Washington Monthly rates you on your student outcomes. What's the educational experience like? Do your students go to get jobs? What kind of jobs do they get? Are they in debt? Do they go to graduate and professional schools? That's telling you that St. Mary's College is doing an excellent job placing and educating our students. We have been designated a college of distinction. In 2018, we're a hidden gem for women in STEM, which is important, especially you think about the changing demographic. More and more women are becoming scientists and engineers. It is good to know that they succeed at St. Mary's College. And if you think about the environment that we live in, it's a very fragile environment down there on the peninsula. And we're ranked sixth in the top 50 green colleges in the nation by Princeton Review. So if you take all these data in account, St. Mary's College, we're proud to be Maryland's public honors college and the first honors college in the nation, but actually we are the national public honors college and we wear that distinction very proudly. To stay at that level, we can't rest on our laurels. We have to constantly think about our curriculum, and we're really restructuring our curriculum so that our students are successful in the 21st century. That requires, when you think about the public discourse, you can't think just about careers. Liberal arts colleges are excellent at preparing students for careers. But the people these days are talking about jobs. And does a liberal arts college prepare a student for that first job? We're working on new curriculum that gets us to that point. And we're really collaborating with local businesses and institutions to make it happen. This new curriculum we're rolling out in the fall is called LEAD, Learning Through Experiential and Applied Discovery. It is for all of our students, not just certain students on a track. Because as a public institution, if you know something is good for one kid, you have to offer it and make it for everyone. So all of our students will be involved in this curriculum. It's responsive to our mission about access and affordability. It prepares our students for that first job and their career. It will integrate the intellectual and practical experiences so that our liberally educated students are not only deep thinkers, but they're doer and they can practically apply what they've learned, because they're going to learn how to take multidisciplinary approaches to solving real-world problems. So St. Mary's College of Maryland, we are proudly Maryland's Public Honors College. We are also the National Public Honors College. We have national prominence. We're locally relevant. We're here to serve. I'll take your questions now if you have any.
How are you doing with your enrollment goals?
So right now we're in, what do you call it? Students are applying. The application deadline or today. Last fall we surpassed our goals. We are trying to stabilize our enrollment. We seem to be headed in the right direction. Good. So we're feeling pretty good about it.
And today's the first day of classes back, right, since the snow day yesterday?
Yeah, yesterday was really hard. I did not want to close the college. That just drives me a little bit crazy. But
this past fall, our new student admissions were up over 10%. So
good.
Great.
That was a very good sign that we're doing the right things to have a good, stable enrollment.
So the one number in your presentation that I'd love to see improved from our perspective is the 8% that are local new students. I'd love to see that number increase. And I'll tell you what I told Dr. Murphy at CSM when I sat down with her. I would love to see a more intentional focus on a partnership between CSM and St. Mary's College and the Higher Ed Center. Now, I'm sure you all work together, and I love hearing how many people come from CSM to go to St. Mary's College, but St. Mary's College is down in my district, and I want to see it continue to succeed. I love the river concerts, and I love what you're doing there, but I'd love to see more local numbers. So instead of fourth on your list, I think we should be first on your list of where people are coming from, because I know you kind of skipped over diversity when you were talking about a lot of your emphasis. There can be a lot of diversity focus coming right from St. Mary's County for St. Mary's College.
I absolutely agree with you, and when I became the president, that people were surprised and supportive that I'm the president of St. Mary's College, because it has not been considered the most diverse place in the county. And I will say that over the last few years, the diversity of our incoming student has increased steadily. And so it's not just racial and ethnic diversity. It is about where the students live, their socioeconomic status, and we talk about neurodiversity a lot. It is all of that, trying to enrich and enhance that college campus. So I totally get it. And we're working really hard for that. But you know, it takes in higher ed world anyway, it takes like 10 years to get a cultural shift, right? Oh, yeah. And so that's why it's so important that every chance we get, when we can outreach to the community, different communities, then we take the opportunity to do that. We must do that if we're going to survive long term. So I agree with you. We have to strengthen our articulation agreements with the College of Southern Maryland. We're now at the table when they're talking about what's going on with this merger between USM and the Southern Maryland Higher Ed Center, because this should not be a competition.
Right.
That we have to be here as public servants. There have to be opportunities for every student, and we should be able to sit down at that table and figure out to make sure there's a pathway for every type of student in this county. So we got to do a better job of that. But I want you to know, you're here now. Tawanda's going to be sitting at that table. It's going to be a different kind of relationship, because if you're talking to Dr. Murphy, there's change going on at the Higher Ed Center. We should be able to be at a better place.
Excellent. And I'm excited about your new stadium and making use of that new turf field you're going to put in there. That's going to be great for the southern part of the county.
I love sitting on a decent seat when I go to games, so I think that's going to be excellent.
Thank you. Well, you keep your costs down, and keeping that tuition straight, and with your prominence in the country and everything, and of course in the state, this is great that you can do that. Keeping that stable, it makes, talking about diversity, you'll get more students in there with the cost.
Yeah, but you
that's,
know.
That's always the big thing with going to college is the cost.
Yeah, here's a challenge though, which I want some of these minds to help us figure this out, right? Because when you offer excellent education, you have to pay for the people.
True, mm-hmm. That's true.
People, if you look at our budget, that's the biggest chunk of our budget, paying for people. So how do you supply excellence at that level and not be able to pay the people and attract them here and keep them here?
We see the same thing here, believe it or not.
Sure.
It's the same thing. The
people it's everywhere.
Right. It's paying them what they're worth. Paying them what they're worth.
Yeah, you got to pay them.
You have to.
It's a trend that's changing everywhere in government, and you see it, that people are actually looking to see the investment that people are giving back into the government and looking at the value that's added from those individuals versus just a number.
That's exactly right.
A position. Fill it, push the paper, and go. So I think you're on the right track, and that trend is changing everywhere. So thank you.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank
Have
you.
A great week.
And
thank you.
It looks good for us in our college, and I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. That's all of our agenda items for today.
Okay. Well, it sounds like we have completed another successful meeting. We are now adjourned.